Amen. All right, Genesis 24:40. We've been using this scripture every week. It says this. This is about Abraham. The Lord in whose presence I walk, the Lord in whose presence I walk habitually, will send his angel with you and prosper your way, and you'll take a wife for my son, for my kindred, and from my father's house. So Abraham was giving those instructions to his servant, and he said that he walked in the presence of the Lord habitually. So that's a good habit to have. A lot of times, like I've said every week, a lot of people want the blessing of Abraham. Man, that Abraham had faith. That Abraham was blessed. He was rich in gold and cattle and silver and men servants and maid servants. He's the father of faith. And we want a life like Abraham. Well, there's a key to Abraham's life. He had a habit in his life. What was that habit? He walked in the presence of the Lord habitually. So your habits are going to determine what kind of life you're going to have. We see that a habit is a recurrent pattern of behavior acquired by frequent repetition, a customary manner, or practice. In Acts 17:2, we read this. According to his usual habit, Paul went to the synagogue. We found out about Jesus in Luke 4:16, and he came to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day. So, I mean, they had a habit of going to church. You've already got a good habit. You're in church today. But it needs to be a habit in your life. So we see that these great giants, we see Jesus Christ even, and then Paul and then Abraham, they had habits in their life that brought great things and the power of God and the blessing of God in their life. And so we need to have habits that will do the same thing. So biblical habits. And I wanted to think about this a little. I was thinking about it last night. Biblical habits benefit us on multiple levels. So when we talk about having a habit, you know, some of the habits we had, meditation in God's Word, that was, I think, the first habit we started with. We talked about daily prayer was a habit. When I say meditating God's Word, I mean thinking about it, speaking it, muttering it, thinking about it over and over, meditating on it. So meditation in God's Word, prayer, living worry-free, operating in the God kind of love in your life. It's a difference between the God kind of love and natural human love. The habit of speaking God's Word. So we've been looking at some of these habits, but all of these habits affect you inwardly. They change you inwardly as you apply them over a period of time. Not only that, they affect the people around you. And then these habits have the ability to affect your circumstances in life. Because the Bible talks about the manifold wisdom of God. And when you're applying God's word in your life, it's many-fold in its application and it does all kinds of things in your life. So, you're walking in love. It affects your relationship with God. It affects the faith operating. Faith works by love. It affects your relationship with other people, how you respond. You're patient and kind, and you don't take into account a wrong suffered. Well, that affects your relationship with other people. And then it's a powerful spiritual force in your life that enables your faith to accomplish what faith is supposed to do and cause you to be a world overcomer. So all of these habits affect your life on multiple levels. They should affect you inwardly and they should affect you outwardly is what I'm saying. Now, inwardly, God has a plan for your life. For every single believer, when you give your life to Jesus Christ, he's doing something. He wants to work in your life. He has an overreaching purpose in your life. Somebody said, well, I don't know what God wants with me. Well, the Bible makes it very plain. In fact, in Romans chapter 8, verse 29, notice what it says here, Romans 8:29. For those whom he foreknew, of whom he was aware and loved beforehand, that's you, he also destined from the beginning, foreordaining them to be molded into the image of his Son and share inwardly his likeness, that he might become the firstborn among many brethren. So God's plan for your life is for you inwardly to be like Jesus Christ and to have what the Bible calls the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faithfulness, humility, self-control. All of that will identify you to the world around you that you're a disciple of Jesus. Because you may not look like him on the outside, but on the inside you have this, you're molded inwardly and you have his patience and his kindness and his love and his self-control and his faith. And you have all of these things in you, and those things in you, if you want change on the outside, change begins on the inside. So this power of God changes us inwardly, but it'll change our relationship with people, and then it'll change our relationship with circumstances. It will change your relationship with circumstances. Instead of being defeated by the circumstances of life, you become a world overcomer. Because that's what he created you to be, was an overcomer. Is that right? This is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. How many of you know we have faith? We've got a measure of faith. So we're world overcomers. So your habits affect you on all these multiple levels. Now, the habit we're going to talk about today, it does the same thing. We're going to talk about this habit. It's the habit of tithes, offerings, and generosity. When we talk about money, you know, some people, and you'll find out why, because I'm going to read you a scripture, but some people, they seem to get upset when you talk about tithing and giving and being generous. And I'm not just talking about even being generous in the church. I'm talking about being generous in life. But there's a reason. You know, Jesus talked more about money than he did about heaven. He talked more about money than he did the new birth, and he talked more about money than he did hell. And there's reason why. I don't understand all the ramifications, but some of the things that he talked about money are very, very interesting, because every single one of us in here in life, we deal with money. And if your money's not right, if you're messed up in money and you don't have enough money, it is a disaster for your life. It causes struggle. A lot of people are divorced over money. Did you know that's one of the top three reasons people divorce? Money. Money, honey. So money's important to your life. I mean, it's important to your family. It's important to taking care of your family. And Jesus knew about it, and the Bible says a lot about it. And let me just say this. It was never God's plan when he created humanity for people to live in poverty or to struggle financially and to be worried and fretful about paying their bills and where am I going to live and how am I going to feed my kids and how am I going to put clothes on their back. And it was never God's plan. And if you want to know God's plan, you go back to the book of beginnings, which is the book of Genesis, and you see how God created things, and that's the way he wanted it to be. So if we go back to the book of Genesis chapter 2, notice what it says here. So this is where God created man, the very beginning of everything. And it says, I don't know what scriptures I gave him, probably verse 7. And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden. Everybody say Eden. Now, the Hebrew language is very, you know, we translate it over into English, and they have a lot more meaning in their words than we do, so sometimes it's kind of hard. That's why when you read the Amplified Bible, it's got so many English words trying to say what the Hebrew or the Greek is. But the word Eden actually means delight or pleasant. So he put him in a place of delight. Everybody say delight. Now I want you to keep that in your mind, just kind of put it over there in a spot. Say it again, delight. So Eden was a place of delight. And notice it says, the Lord God planted the garden. Who made the garden? God made the garden. And I mean, this garden was pretty amazing. It says, the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, a place of delight or pleasantness. And there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. Now other translations say beautiful and amazing things. So the Lord God made everything. The Lord God made grow everything that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. And the tree of life also was in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And I mean, if you read up, I mean, verse 6, it says, there went a mist up from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground. It didn't rain, so God put in an underground sprinkler system. And so, sometime in the night or before dawn, the water would come up and water everything. Stephen thought that he came up with that, you know, but he didn't. He's a landscape company. So I'm just jacking with him. But no, God came up with that underground sprinkler system. And it watered everything, and it was a place of delight. It was a place of plenty. God's the one that made the garden. It produced all this amazing fruit, good for food, everything. It would grow. It was supernatural. It was good to eat. It was beautiful to look at. It was just an amazing place, and that's where God wanted mankind to be. And he put him in this garden, and really his plan was for man to go out and to extend the garden with a little bit of his own style and a little bit of his own taste all over the face of the whole earth. So there was no lack there. There was no hunger. There was no worry. There was no fret. There was no evil. It was this amazing place that God had created for mankind to live, and that's the way he wanted us to live. He never wanted us to struggle and to worry and to be fretful and to be living under a cursed system where everybody's trying to get enough money so they can get out of the rat race and not be under the burden of, man, I got to make this payment, I got to do that, I got this going on. And he didn't want us to live that way. But something happened, of course, and mankind sinned. And when mankind sinned in Genesis chapter 3, notice what it says over here. Genesis 3 verse 17, something dramatically changed. And unto Adam, this is after they sinned, they took of the tree they weren't supposed to eat of because it belonged to God. They took his part. And unto Adam he said, because you have hearkened unto the voice of your wife and have eaten of the tree of which I commanded you, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Notice what happened. Cursed is the ground for your sake. In sorrow shall you eat of it all the days of your life. And the word sorrow here in the Hebrew says painful toil. That's not the way he created it to be. He created it to grow. He created everything to be produced. God was the one who planted the garden. He had everything there. But when man sinned, something changed in the earth. It still changed in the earth. The earth operates under an earth-cursed system because sin came into the world. So it says, in sorrow, painful toil, you'll eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to you. You shall eat the herb of the field. Notice this, in the sweat of your face. In the sweat of your face shall you eat bread. So something has changed drastically. Till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken. Dust you are, dust you return. So everything changed because mankind sinned. Now, God loved mankind so much that he looked for a way to protect man from some of these devastating effects that came with the fall of man. We know, you know, Romans 5 says, by one man's sin entered into the world, death by sin. We know the earth became filled with violence. But God wanted to protect his people. He wanted to have a way to protect people. So, of course, he made a covenant. And the covenant that he made was a temporary covenant that would be until the Lord Jesus Christ would come and make a new covenant. But under this old covenant, the purpose of the covenant was to help people to be free from the curse. And everything hinged on two things in the old covenant. You can say what you want, but it hinged on two things. And those two things were, according to Jesus in Matthew 22. Notice what they are. This is how you know. Well, what's old covenant about? Notice Matthew 22, 37 says this. Jesus said unto him, somebody came and says, what's the great commandment? Here's what he said. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. Then he said this. The second's like unto it. Love your neighbors yourself. Then he said this. On these two commandments hang how much of the law? All of the law and all of the prophets. So you got to keep this in mind. Everything that's in the law, when you read about the commandments in the law, the whole object of it was to show people what it was really like, because they didn't understand love anymore. They died spiritually, were separated from God who is love. So he says, I'm doing this so you'll understand these two things. This is how you love God, because that's what the whole law and the prophets was about. This is how you show you love God, and this is how you show you love people. You don't murder, you don't lie, you don't steal. I'm showing you these things. He said, this is what the whole law is about. This is how you demonstrate you love God and you demonstrate that you love people. So that's the whole law. According to Jesus, it's the whole law and the prophets. So everything you read in the law, when it talks about giving, about what belongs to God, remember the whole overreaching purpose of what he's telling us is this is how you demonstrate you love God and you love people. Everybody say it out loud. Love God, love people. And since they couldn't do it naturally because they weren't born again, he had to show them, this is how you do it. So when we read some of the things out of the law, you'll see, you have to ask yourself, now, what was the purpose of this? Love God, love people. Say it again. Love God, love people. So I'm going to give you three things about why tithing, giving offerings, and being generous is so important to your life spiritually. In fact, it impacts your life on multiple levels. So in Leviticus, first point is this. I'm just going to give you three points, and I'll be kind of quick. Honoring God financially invites Him into your financial life. I said it invites Him into your financial life. And why do you need God in your financial life? Because He don't want you living under this system to where it's painful toil and you're living under a cursed system and you've just got to scratch and try to get it yourself and hoard and save up and live in fear. There's a better way. It's a way to where God is the one who's provided and He'll supernaturally help you in your life. And you need to get over in this part to where you can live with His supernatural help financially, because he never created man to live that way. So why should you tithe? Why does it matter? And why should you honor God with tithes and then be generous and give offerings and be generous? I mean, just in life with other people, why should you do it? So I'm gonna give you these principles about, you know, how this affects your life. And so honoring God financially invites Him into your financial life. Notice in Leviticus 27, verse 30, here's what He said. Now remember the law, purpose of the law, what did He say? Everything hangs on two things, love God, love people. Everybody say it again, love God, love people. So Leviticus is the law. Notice what He says. One-tenth of the produce of the land, whether grain or the fields, or fruit of the trees, belongs to the Lord and must be set apart to Him as... Who does it belong to? The Lord. Why would He tell you to do that? Because He wants to know, love me. Love me. This is how you show you love me. You honor me with your income. You honor me with what's produced in your life. And that's demonstrating I'm really first. If we don't get it down to where God's really first in our life, then nothing else is really going to work the way that it should. Now, this can be scary. It can be difficult. And it can be hard on the flesh. When you start giving God one-tenth, that's the word tithe. But when you start doing that, maybe you've never done it. Maybe you've never told that was something that was scriptural and in the Bible. You say, well, that's Old Testament law. I know, but the purpose was to show that you love God and love people. That's the whole purpose of the two great commandments in the law. So He said, one-tenth of the produce of the land belongs to the Lord. And this is not easy. In fact, Jesus... Very interesting the way Jesus kind of described this relationship between human beings, between you, between me, and between our money. And in Matthew chapter 16, here's what Jesus said about this. Matthew 16, verse 13. No one can serve two masters. You will either hate one and love the other. You will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. The Pharisees who dearly loved their, who are you supposed to love? And what did the Pharisees love? They dearly loved their money, heard all this, and what did they do to Him? So you know why people get mad? Well, you know, if I talk about money, and I mean, I'm not taking up an offering, so just relax, just be cool. You're cool, nobody ain't gonna know nothing, baby. Why do they scoff at Him? They dearly loved their money. Don't be jacking with my money. Are you here? Amen. So you can see. Now, if it had been me, and I'm just, you know, I'm not Jesus. Jesus is a lot smarter than I am. Smarter than you too. I would have said, you cannot serve. I probably wouldn't have said, you cannot serve God and money. I would have probably said it this way. You can't serve God and the devil. Probably what I would have said. I mean, if it's me, if I'm just thinking about this, you can't serve God and the devil. You better decide who you're going to serve. Can't serve God and the devil. But then I got to thinking, you know, really the main issue with people is it's really not people saying, who am I going to serve, God or the devil? No, most people know, I don't believe I'm going to be serving the devil. That's really not that big of a temptation for most people. Now, there are a few knuckleheads that are mixed up. I mean, I'll grant you that. But really, that's not a big decision with a lot of people. Am I going to serve God or the devil? It's really not that. But it is a challenge for everybody. Are you going to serve God and money? Because the reason why is because we live in a system to where the only way you can get free and get relief from the pressure of life and trying to, you know, feed your kids and pay your bills and is to save, that's what we think, to work hard and gain, and you try to hold on to it and not lose it. and it just ticks you off if you lose something. You know, if you invest and it don't work out, and you're, oh my gosh, I can't believe that. And you're under this pressure. And so he said, you're going to have this battle whether you're going to be attached to money or you're going to be attached to God. And he's wanting a way to show you love God so God can get involved in your finances where you're not trapped in this struggle in life. Where you're not trapped in it. There is a way out to where you can be in a place of delight, in a place of Eden. Now notice, let me show you what I'm talking about. In Malachi chapter 3, this is once again, it's under the law, purpose of the law. The purpose of the law for this discussion is, Jesus said everything hanged on these two things, love God, love people. But notice in Malachi 3 in verse 10, here's what he said about it. He said, bring all the tithe, that's the same word, tenth part, into the storehouse so there'll be enough food in my temple. If you do, says the Lord of heaven's armies, I will open the windows of heaven for you. I will pour out a blessing so great you won't have enough room to take it in. Try it. Put me to the test. Try it. Put me to the test. So he said, I'll do something if you will demonstrate you love me and that I'm first in your life and that you don't love money more than you love me. He said, if you'll put me first, then I'm going to do something. I'm going to get you out of this system. I'm going to break the back of this system to where it's wearisome toil and struggle, and it's just what you can scratch and dig and get yourself. I'm going to do something. I will open the windows of heaven. I'll pour you out a blessing so you won't even have room enough to receive it. So that God's wanting to free us, but I mean, you're going to have a struggle with it because of the system you're raised in. Your mindset is, man, I'm going to scrape it. I'm going to get all I can all I get. And that's kind of the way that we think, and we don't understand there's a better way to live. And God wants to get you in this better way to live to where he's your source and he's involved in your life financially. Notice what it says in Proverbs 3, verse 9 and 10. I like this, Proverbs 3, 9 and 10. Honor the Lord with your wealth and with the first of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled with what? And your vats will burst forth with wine. What did he say? He said, all right, now you start honoring me with the first part. First part, you put me first. Jesus said, seek first the kingdom of God. So he's just saying that it also includes your financial life. And if you'll do it financially, something's going to happen. God's going to get involved over here. He's going to do things for you where it's not just you scratching and digging and trying to get it yourself. He's going to get involved financially in your life. And so that's why we honor God financially. We put him first. And I tell you what, when people really do that and they understand this principle and they apply it correctly, changes everything. I personally know people who are millionaires today. Personally know millionaires today. And if you started asking them what drastically changed in your life, it's because they found out about this. And they started operating in this supernatural provision from God. And it wasn't that they worked out something, they figured this all. It was the hand of God that moved in their life. It was God supernaturally doing something to break the curse and to cause them to be blessed. You know, I read a testimony. I thought it was very interesting. Another pastor had wrote this, and he said he's pastoring his church, and there was a lady in the church. Her husband wasn't a Christian. He wasn't even saved. And he had a construction business. Well, in fact, he was a partner. He was, him and another man owned the construction business. Neither one of them were Christians. They didn't even attend church. But they'd had a construction business. There was a downturn. And I mean, they were struggling financially, and they're about to go broke. So they had just a certain period of time. Bank says, you're fixing to, we're going to pull the plug on you, boys. So they were desperate. And so this wife, her husband came to her. She was a church member. And came and asked the pastor, said, my husband wanted me to ask you something. I don't even know, you know, but he's asking this. If they start tithing off of their business, would the church take their tithes? And the pastor, he thought about it. He said, well, your husband's not a Christian. His partner's not a Christian. I don't really know that it would work. I don't know if it'll work or not. He said, but Yeah, if they bring them up here, we'll take the tithe. I mean, I don't know of any preachers that say, no, I'm not taking any tithe. So, I mean, pretty much he's going to take, all right. So they started tithing on the jobs that they get. So they started tithing, and something started happening miraculously. And they said in a short period of time, it was several weeks, you know, it was a period of time passed, but their business just absolutely did a 180, turned around. They paid all of the debt that they owed. They got out of debt and got in the black, and their business started prospering. It so impacted this unbelieving man that he came to church and dedicated his life to Christ and got saved. Not only that, I thought this was kind of funny. As the company started growing, when he would interview people for work, and the first thing he'd ask him, he says, do you tithe? Because if you don't tithe, I'm not hiring you. I only hire tithers. Wow. But God wants to impact your life. He wants to be involved in your financial life. Everybody say it out loud. God wants to be involved in my financial life. He just wants to be. He don't want you living where it's all up to you and you're living under this system of weary toil and curse. All right, second thing. Why do you need to tithe and give offerings and be generous? The seed must lead. Everybody say it out loud. The seed must lead. Now, I mean, I don't have time to teach it, but you know that Jesus said the whole kingdom of God operates on the single principle, as if a man should cast seed into the ground. He said that's the way it works. And that's, you know, that's in Mark chapter 4 over there in verse 26. And I didn't give him that scripture, but I'm just bringing that up to you. But notice that the Bible shows us that money is also a seed. And a lot of times we don't think about it that way. In 2 Corinthians 9, verse 6 through 8, it says it this way. Remember this, he who sows, now that's a farming term, isn't it? He who sows sparingly and grudgingly will also reap sparingly and grudgingly. And he who sows generously, that blessings may come to someone, will also reap generously and with blessings. And then notice what it says in verse, we're just going to keep reading here. I want to read a little bit more, I think. Verse 7. Let each one give as he's made up his own mind and purposed in his heart, not reluctantly or sorrowfully or under compulsion, for God loves, he takes pleasure in, prizes above other things, and is unwilling to abandon or do without a cheerful, joyous, prompt to do it giver whose heart is in his giving. Then it says in verse 8, God's able to make all grace. See, the whole point is this. Hey, I don't want you living under this curse. If you'll get me involved, I'm able to make all grace, every favor and earthly blessing come to you. I'm able to make it come to you, God says, in abundance. So that you may always and under all circumstances. Well, what if the economy's not good, doing good? All circumstances. And whatever the need, be self-sufficient, possessing enough to require no aid or support, furnished in abundance for every good work and charitable donation. Everybody say, God's able. But you gotta give him, you gotta give him some right to get involved. And you got to remember money is seed that you sow, because the whole kingdom of God operates that way. And a lot of people, I mean, they hear a faith message. I'm a faith preacher. I mean, who wants to be a doubt and unbelief preacher? I'm a faith preacher. So we hear about words. One of our principles is speaking the word of God. I believe in speaking the word of God. I believe in using your faith, absolutely. Just shall live by faith. But it don't do a farmer any good if he wants a crop of tomatoes. It don't do him one bit of good to go out to the ground and talk to it and say, I say I'm going to have a record harvest of tomatoes. I say it in the name of Jesus. Don't matter, for he meditates the word of God. If he prays over the ground, he can talk to it. He's not getting one tomato if he hasn't planted any tomato seed. God's going to multiply. He's able to multiply your seed sown. That's what it talks about. But if you don't sow any seed, what's he got to multiply? What's he got to bless if you don't have any seed in the ground? Are you here? And a lot of people, they don't get this. And I mean, I'm just saying, you got to get some seed in the ground. The seed's got to lead. And then God's got something to bless, to water, supernaturally. He's got something to multiply in your life, but the seed's got to leave. You got to get some seed out there. There's a great story about this in 1 Kings chapter 17. I'm going to flip over there. 1 Kings 17. Everybody knows about Elijah. I hope maybe you don't. He's a prophet in the Old Testament. A lot of miracles happened in Elijah's life and ministry. And 1 Kings 17, we see one that had to do with finances. So here's what he says. Verse 10, so he arose and went to Zarephath, and when he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow woman was there gathering of sticks. And he called to her and said, fetch me, I pray you, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. Everybody say, widow woman. Now, she is struggling under an earth curse system. Struggling. Buddy, you think it's rough now? Anywhere? This woman was a widow woman in a rough time of the world where everybody was a farmer. And if you didn't, I mean, how are you going to? You had to have stuff regularly coming in. And it says, he said, fetch me a little water in a vessel that I may drink. And as she was going to fetch it, he called to her and said, bring me, I pray thee, a morsel of bread in thine hand. And she said, as the Lord thy God lives, I have not a cake, but a handful of meal in a barrel and a little oil in a cruse. And behold, I'm gathering two sticks that I may go in and dress it for me and for my son that we may eat it and die. This is our last food. And Elijah said unto her, everybody say, Elijah said. Now, it's interesting. I mean, some of you already know. I know we have Bible school students here. Some of you already know. What does Elijah mean? The word Elijah in the Hebrew language means my God is. And so Elijah said unto her, fear not, go and do as thou hast said, but make me thereof a little cake. When? Who was she supposed to give it to? Elijah. Everybody say Elijah. What does Elijah mean? My God is. So he said, my God is. Now, I mean, if I did that, if there's a widow woman coming up here, she came to church, she's a pastor, I got medicine to buy, I don't have any money to eat on, and I say, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go home, whatever money you have left, I want you to bake me a cake, and I want it to be a chocolate cake, and I want it, lots of chocolate on it. And I want you to bring it up to here, and you give that to me first, and then we'll just see about your medicine. I'd be on 60 Minutes. I'd be on YouTube, I'd be all over the world, and they'd be saying, oh, my God. What a reprobate. All of those preachers are in it for money. But see, there's another spiritual law people don't understand. And the spiritual law is this: when you put God first, there's another system that will kick in to where God will get involved and he will supernaturally provide, because he don't want you out here scratching and digging and weary toil and sweating and worrying about how you're going to pay your bills. So she went and did. Notice what it says. Elijah said, make me a cake first and bring it unto me, and after make for thee and thy son. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil fail until the day that the Lord sends rain on the earth. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah, and she and he and her house did eat many days. The margin of my King James Bible says, for a full year. And the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil fail according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Elijah. So she put God first, she gave God his part first, and something supernatural kicked in because God, when you put him first, love God, love people, all of a sudden, this is all that God was trying to get him to do. I'm first in your life, you put me first, you demonstrate you love me more than you love money. You put me first, and then something supernatural kicks in and God begins to move in your life financially. So you got to give him a right to move in your life. And the seed must lead. Everybody say it out loud. The seed must lead. All right, listen. Here's the last thing. Listen to this. God's blessing requires giving and believing. Now, I know some people that have given and they give because they love God and their motives are right. And they believe or they wouldn't be given. But I believe most people are not believing about their giving as much as they should be. In other words, they need to help this seed along by their faith. In Malachi chapter 3, notice what it says here. I'm talking about giving and believing. Malachi 3, go back to verse 10, and I'm going to read a little bit more. Bring all the tithe into the storehouse, tenth part, that there may be meat in my house. Prove me now, here we say, the Lord of hosts. If I'll not open you the windows of heaven. What did God say he'd do? Open you the windows of heaven. Pour you out a blessing. There will not be room enough to receive it. Verse 11, what does it say? I'll rebuke the devourer for your sake. He shall not destroy the fruits of your ground, neither shall your vine cast her fruit before the time in the field, saith the Lord of hosts. Verse 12, all nations shall call you what? Blessed, for you shall be a, what kind of land? A delightsome land. What was Eden? It was a place of delight, saith the Lord of hosts. Verse 13, your words have been stout against me, saith the Lord, yet you say, how have we spoken so much against you? Verse 14, you have said it's vain to serve God. What profit is it that we have kept your ordinance and that we have walked mournfully before the Lord of hosts? So they were saying it doesn't do any good to keep God's ordinance. It doesn't do any good to do this. It's really not profiting us. So the issue was they weren't obeying God and they didn't believe in it and they were talking like they didn't believe in it. So if you want to turn this situation around, not only do you plant the seed, not only do you put God first, and you honor him with your finances, but you need to be believing in this principle of if I put God first, he already said he'd open the windows of heaven. Jesus already said, if I'd seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, all these other things would be added to me. And you need to stir yourself up by meditating those scriptures, getting faith in those, and then speaking them out of your mouth. You know, in Hebrews 4:2, there's this amazing scripture that a lot of people forget. It says the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with what? In them that heard it. And it's talking about people that heard the word, they didn't make it into the promised land. How come? They didn't mix any faith with the word that was told them. So if you want the full benefit, and some people have been blessed in a certain measure, my mom and dad, they tithed their whole life. They gave offerings, they were generous. But they did it out of being taught to do that, and they loved God, and they did it because they cared about the kingdom of God, and that's the right motive. But they didn't do a lot of talking about it. They didn't release their faith in speaking. Now, God helped them supernaturally because they tithed. I mean, when my dad got ready to retire, another company bought the company he worked for, and his retirement doubled in the last 6 months or so that he was there because the other company had a lot better retirement. And he made as much money when he retired as he did when he was working. God's blessing, God's hand, God helps us. But I'm just saying this, you got to mix some faith with it. You got to start, if you want the benefits, when you tithe, when you write out that check, when you're driving out, whenever you're thinking about this, you need to start saying, according to God's word, I'm a tither. God's first in my life. And the blessing of the Lord's on me. He's multiplying my seeds on, and I'm prospering according to God's word. And you start mixing your faith with it so it will profit you to the max. I want it to profit you to the max. What you say and what you believe matters a whole lot. That's how you water that seed that you planted. That's how you nourish the plants, the harvest that's coming up by the words that come out of your mouth. Proverbs 10:22, listen to this scripture. The blessing of the Lord, it maketh what? That means to have an abundant supply, that word rich. An abundant supply. That's exactly what they had in the Garden of Eden, an abundant supply. There was no lack. The blessing of the Lord, it maketh rich, and he adds no. What was he trying to get mankind out of? Sorrowful toil. So the blessing of the Lord, that's what he wants in your life. How do you activate that blessing? You put God first. You demonstrate, I love God, and I'm demonstrating it. And I love people, and that's the whole purpose of the law. So when you do this, you got to believe and you got to start speaking. And I mean, it starts changing everything in your life financially. It'll change your business. Do you tithe out of your business? Oh, I don't do that. I don't tithe out of my business. Okay. So you're saying, I'll handle the business, God. I don't need you in my business. I don't really need your blessing in that. I'm a pretty smart guy and I'll take care of that. Okay. Go for it. Let's just see how that works out over an extended period of time. Because you can lose the blessing when you get over here into not doing what God said. So I'm just saying, you got to mix some faith with God's word. Here's what God's word said. I'm going to speak God's word. I'm going to believe God's word. I want to be blessed, and the blessing of the Lord makes rich. And he said he'd open the windows of heaven and pour me out a what? A blessing. Everybody say a blessing. Well, that's what you want. You want to live under the blessing. You know the greatest thing you can do for your kids? Well, I'm going to get them a real good education. Well, that might help, might not. There's a lot of smart people that have a disastrous life. You teach them to live in the blessing. Teach them to live in the blessing. You teach them to live in the blessing. Because let me tell you something, God can do more for you in one moment of time than anybody else could ever do for you, than all your education and all your smarts and all your wits and all the things you've learned could ever do for you. God can do more in one moment of time, with one move, with one call, with one influence in your life. The blessing of the Lord. And he said, I'll open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing if you put me first. So that's why this affects every area of your life. And you know, when you tithe, when you put God first, when you make that decision to do that, it breaks something on the inside of you. It starts, because we're all tempted to be self-centered. But he's wanting to mold us into his image, to where we're generous and we're not putting ourselves first. And it'll start impacting all of your life. So it's a habit you need to have of being generous. I mean, when you go to a restaurant, are you generous? Do you tip well? Or are you a tightwad? Don't raise your hand. I mean, I'm not. I mean, when you're buying a gift for your wife, I mean, you need to be generous. I'm not saying you buy things you can't afford. I'm not talking about that. But what is your heart like? Are you, if you're willing to spend, you know, $2,000 on a set of golf clubs and you don't think a whole lot about that, but your wife's birthday comes up or something, and then, you know, you buy her a pair of socks. I mean, I'm just saying, you're probably not very generous. Are you here? You need to learn to be generous with people. You need to learn to tip big. I'm not talking about showing out. I'm just saying being a blessing to people. Those people working at those tables are maybe making minimum wage or a little bit more, and in one moment you can be a blessing and help to them. You can change their whole day. You can make them happy. Are you here? Generosity. He that waters will be watered also himself. When you bless, you bless with your words, you bless with your actions, you bless with your attitude, and you bless with your money. And I tell you what, it just comes back. Jesus said, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. You can't outgive God. And when you remember the whole reason he talked about tithing and giving offerings, all that was to show them, this is how you love God, and this is how you love people. You don't lie, you don't steal, you don't murder, you don't do all this stuff. And you keep God first. You don't take his name in vain. You don't have any other idols above God. You don't have that. He said, this is how you put God. You keep him up here, and it affects every area of your life. Amen.